Most folks who use Python on Windows just download an existing pre-built binary for Python. But if you want to, or if you need to, you can compile your own build of Python on Windows. And in this video, I'm going to show you how. First off, why might you do this? Well, one, if you want to get more familiar with Python's internals, it can be useful to get familiar with the process of building Python generally. Another, and this is something that's actually really important right now with Python 3.13, is if you want to enable features in Python that are only available at compile time and aren't enabled in the stock Python builds. There may be builds in the future that have those features, but until then, you'll have to build Python yourself to get access to those extras. So let's walk through the steps needed to build Python on Windows. Now first, you're going to need to install the Visual Studio Build Tools. This is a suite of command line tools for Windows, which lets you build Visual Studio C or C++ projects without needing the whole of the Visual Studio product, which can be quite large. Now, in a previous video, which I'm going to link in the description, I talked about how you could do this by way of a simple one-liner in PowerShell. And this one-liner sets up the Visual Studio installer utility, which is what I'm showing here. It adds the build tools, and it also sets up the proper additional components. You generally need to just check the desktop development with C++ box to get the core tooling that you need to build Python. Now, once you have the Visual Studio build tool set up, you can grab this Python source code and place it in a directory. If you have Git, and you really ought to be using Git for this, the easy way to do this is with Git clone. And once the cloning process is finished, you're going to have the full source tree for CPython in a subdirectory. Inside the source tree, there's a subdirectory named pcbuild. This is where the project and the build tools exist for the Windows version of CPython. And the nice folks in the CPython project have provided shell scripts and batch files to automate much of the build process overall. In this case, the batch file that you're going to want to work with is called build.bat. If you run it with the h flag, you'll get detailed help about what flags you can pass to the build process. So for this one, we're just going to focus on a few key flags. The PGO flag enables what's called profile guided optimization, or PGO. PGO uses analysis of the build binary to determine how to optimize the program's layout and compilation options. What it does is it runs the Python test suite to generate some statistics about the program's behavior and then alters the compilation process to figure out how to make things faster based on what's been observed. The advantage to using PGO is that PGO builds run a little bit faster. They're somewhere around the vicinity of 5 to 10% faster. The stock binaries of Python that you download from python.org are all built with PGO. The downside is the compilation process for a PGO build is much longer. If you just want to build quickly and not for performance, you can omit this option. The two other options I want to draw attention to are newly offered in the Python 3.13 build process. They're for enabling experimental features. These are things that you need to make custom builds of Python to even try out, at least at this point. The first is disable gil, which builds CPython without the gil, so threads can run with true parallelism. I've covered this before in a different video. It's a really exciting feature, but it's still in the very early stages, so it is strictly experimental for now. Another flag is experimental JIT, and this enables yet another exciting feature that I've covered, a runtime JIT in CPython that speeds up some operations, especially in tight loops. But again, it's experimental and a long way from being a standard feature. The other thing is that you can't enable both of these particular options at once. You have to choose either one or the other, at least for now. So for the sake of the demo and to give you an idea of the time involved for this process, I'm going to use the PGO and disable gil options. So we're now going to fast forward through the compilation process. But when you do this yourself, I recommend getting some coffee because it's going to take about 15 minutes to do the whole thing. At least it did on my machine, which is a relatively recent 6-core AMD. Now, if the build process fails, you will get an error in red. But if all you have is warnings, which you can usually ignore, those messages in yellow, you're probably okay. And if you see build succeeded in green, like this, at the end of the build process, then you're good. Now, once the build process is finished, the actual executable will be located in a subdirectory of PC build, typically named after the machine architecture you built for. In this case, it's AMD 64. Now, if we look in there, you'll see executables, and these should look pretty familiar. Now, the names of these executables are different as a way to distinguish them from the non-free-threaded build, which is why they have these peculiar naming conventions. But if we launch this, you'll see we have a note to that effect, and we have a time date stamp for the build in the welcome message. Otherwise, this is exactly the same as Python we know and love. Now, if you want to use this particular build to run a Python script, the best way to do this is to leave the binaries where they are and to run the script by way of an absolute path reference. For instance, in this folder, where I have the benchmarks that I've been using to gauge the behavior of the free-threaded build of Python, I can use the free-threaded build by just using the full path to it, like this. Now, I should note that there is another build process available. This involves building not just the Python runtime, but an MSI installer to go with it. And that allows you to give it to somebody else and have them deploy it on their machine. But this is a whole separate process that's worth detailing apart from this because it has its own quirks. It's worth going into in another video. So to sum up, to build Python on Windows, you do need the Microsoft Visual Studio build tools installed, but those are available freely and they're not hard to add. Once you've satisfied that requirement, the rest of it is almost totally automatic. Any options you want to pass to the compiler process, you can find out about by using the H flag with the build.bat file. And the easiest way to work with the resulting executable is just to run it in place and refer to it with the full path to the executable. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below. And don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.